do the right thing, 'cause it's the right thing to do, even when you know nobody's
wrong. Well, good morning, boys and girls, and welcome to Gateway Kids. I'm so happy you're joining me this morning. We are going to continue our lessons on integrity. Integrity is choosing to be truthful in whatever you say or do. And I say choosing because it is a choice to be truthful. Sometimes we skew the truth a little bit, but even if it's just a little bit, it's still a non-truth. And that is, or called a lie. I mean, you can call it what it is. But today's story is, we're going to entitle it A Matter of Trust. And we're going to see what happens in this story when someone does something that's not exactly truthful. And that brings us down to our bottom line, which is, when you're not truthful, you lose trust. So when you don't tell the truth to someone and they find out that you didn't tell the truth, the next time, they're not going to trust you. They're going to think that you're going to lie to them again. And so we're going to listen to that story today. But before we do, Miss Terry wants to tell my birthday friends, happy, happy birthday, guys. I hope you have a wonderful birthday. I want to give you a big air hug, or we could do a high five, or we could do an elbow bump. But whatever it is, I just want to say, I hope your day is fantastic and that you enjoy your time with your family. So we're going to go ahead and pray now, and then we are going to get started with his crew. So bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this beautiful day, God. I thank you that, Father, you are a God who is close by. You are always walking beside us, God. Help us to lean into you when we feel like we don't want to tell the complete truth or we want to skew it a little bit. Convict us, Lord. Help us to know that we need to be truthful so that people can trust us in what we say. And Lord, we thank you that you're always there for us. Today, let our hearts and our minds be open and receptive to your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said, Amen. Good job, boys and girls. All right, you know what time it is. It's time to call out his crew. So here we go on the count of three. It's 1, 2, 3.
So simple, faith like a child. I give you an inch and you take me a mile. I feel the wind rush and the thunder roll. 2 feet on the water, only one way to go. Yeah, I don't gotta be afraid no more, no. 'Cause I know you up and through the storm. I'm more than just a talker.
I'll just pray harder. Even in my darkest hour, got Holy Ghost power. When I keep my eyes upon you, Jesus, I'm a wave walker. I'm a wave walker. I'm dancing on water. When the devil tries to shake me, I'll just pray harder. Even in my darkest hour, got Holy Ghost power. When I keep my eyes upon you, Jesus, I'm a wave walker.
I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Good morning, boys and girls. I am so glad you have joined us this morning. We have an awesome Bible story for you to hear today. It is about making wise choices and having integrity. We'll get to hear a story about a man named Naaman, Elisha, and Elisha's servant. I hope you enjoy the story. And when we finish watching the video, we'll come back and we'll have a lesson. See you soon.
Hello, friends. It's me, Graham. And I am a hero! Hee-ya! 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 Oh! 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 Uh-oh. Well, okay, I'm not a real hero, but I'm pretending to be one. It's fun to be a hero because heroes have integrity.
Integrity is choosing to be truthful in whatever you say and do. And heroes, above everything else, are truthful. Of course, it's also fun to pretend to be the villain.
Now you will know the power of the bucket. For I, Buckethead, am your second cousin once removed.
No, that's impossible! We look nothing alike!
Would I lie to you?
Yeah, probably.
You're right, I probably would.
The good thing about pretending to be the bad guy is that I can stop pretending anytime I want. But as you'll see in today's story, when you cheat and lie in real life, it's a little harder to take your mask off.
It's really hard to breathe in here. I'll see you all back here soon.
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. Now, for an amazing story, inspired by the book of 2 Kings, chapter 5.
Naaman was the commander of the army of Aram, one of Israel's greatest enemies.
Forward march!
Though Naaman was a wealthy man, he had one problem that no doctor could solve. He had a terrible skin disease.
Make it go away.
Then Naaman heard news of a prophet in Israel, Elisha, who might be able to help. But instead of going straight to Elisha, Naaman took rich gifts to the king of Israel, along with a letter from the king of his own land explaining how important he was. The king of Israel frowned as he read the letter from his enemy, the king of Aram.
I am sending my servant Naaman to you with this letter. I want you to heal him of his skin disease.
What? No! I'm not God. Your king is trying to pick a fight with me.
But I just
not
want...
Not this thing. La, 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 la.
The king of Israel made such a fuss that Elisha heard the news and sent a messenger. It was probably his trusted servant, Gehazi.
I am a good guy. Trust me.
Gehazi took Elisha's message to the king.
Elisha says, tell the man to come to me.
Gehazi raced back home to help Elisha prepare for the important visitor. And sure enough, the king of Israel sent Naaman straight to their doorstep. Gehazi peeked out the window.
Look how low the chariot is riding. What's in the back? Embroidered robes and bags of something?
Gehazi.
Hurry up. You gotta look good for this guy. I'll get you your best robe.
Nope.
You're not wearing the robe?
I'm not going out.
Not going out?
No, you are.
But my robe?
What's wrong with your robe?
It's old. It's not even a decent name brand like Melchizedek or Queen Jezebel.
Elisha sent his servant out the door with a message for Naaman.
Are you the prophet?
No. But let me just say that is one excellent chariot. I see you got the golden hubcap.
Where's Elisha?
He says, go, wash yourself in the Jordan River 7 times. Then your skin will be healed. You will be pure and clean again.
I thought Elisha would come out himself.
I know, right?
Look, can't he just say some words and wave his hand and, you know, make me better?
That's what I was thinking, too.
And the Jordan River? I mean, it's full of muck and tadpoles and... forget it.
Naaman tore off, angry. But his servants convinced him to follow Elisha's instructions. Naaman dipped 7 times in the murky Jordan River. And when he rose from the water on his 7th time...
What?
His skin was perfectly clean. He was healed.
Unbelievable.
Naaman raced back to Elisha's home. This time, the prophet came outside along with Gehazi. Naaman marveled at his unmarked arms and hands.
Now I know that there is no God anywhere except in Israel. Please take a gift from me.
Gehazi inched closer to the chariot. He could see the richly colored robes hanging over the bags of gold and silver.
Is that a genuine Melchizedek robe?
Uh-huh, the real deal.
Just have your servants unload around back and I'll...
Nope, I serve the Lord. You can be sure that he lives. And you can be just as sure that I won't accept a gift from you.
What?
Please, I'm begging you.
He's begging you, Elisha.
But Elisha still refused to take a single coin from Naaman and send him away in peace. Elisha went back inside, leaving Gehazi speechless on the doorstep.
What? No, seriously?
Gehazi could still see the dust kicked up by the horse's hooves.
Elisha should have taken something. If he didn't want it, he could have just given it to me.
With that, Gehazi took off running down the road. His arms pumped and his sandals flapped as he crested the hill and came up alongside the chariot. Naaman pulled it to a halt.
Is everything all right?
It's fine. Fine. My master sent me to say that two young prophets have come to visit. Yeah, that's it. Please give them 75 pounds of silver and two sets of clothes.
Oh, of course. Take twice as much.
Naaman's servants carried the heavy bags of silver and clothing back up the road. But as they approached Elisha's house...
Hey, thanks. I got it from here.
Straining beneath the weight of his heavy load, Gehazi snuck inside and stashed the clothing and silver in his room. Then he hurried back out and strolled through the front door.
Can't whistle.
Elisha studied him with sharp eyes. Where have you been?
Oh, me? I didn't go anywhere.
Didn't my spirit go with you? I know Naaman greeted you. I know you took money and clothes.
I was just being nice to the horses, making their load lighter.
You and your family after you will have Naaman's skin disease.
But then I can't wear my new robes.
Sure enough, Gehazi's skin was soon covered with sores, just like Naaman's was. Gehazi's lie had won him some new clothes, but it had cost him Elisha's trust and a full and healthy life.
Elisha's servant Gehazi told some lies, didn't he? He lied to himself, saying he needed more stuff than he already had. He lied to Naaman to get the stuff. Then he lied to Elisha about all of it. Maybe Gehazi wasn't a bad guy, but would you be able to trust somebody like that?
Never!
What if someone lied to you? What if they said they were going to keep a secret, but they let it slip out? Or if they said they'd do one thing, but then did something else instead? Do you still trust them?
Oh, no!
It's harder to trust people after they've let you down, right?
Correct!
It works the same way when we're the ones who tell the lie or don't do what we say we'll do. It can make us come across as the villain. So, here's the one very important thing to remember. When you're not truthful, you lose trust. When you are truthful, you're the hero! And if you need even more evidence that being truthful is the way to go, look to Jesus. He always did exactly what he said he would do. He can be trusted no matter what. That's what I want to be.
What do you say, Buckethead? Will you turn from your villainous ways?
Do I get to keep the bucket?
Sure.
It's a deal!
Great! Go be heroes, everyone. Bye!
Hey, Buckethead, how do you feel about tacos?
Did you enjoy that story? I know I did. I was thinking, though, when I was listening to the story that, man, sometimes it can be hard to make right choices all the time, even when nobody's watching. And that's exactly what Elisha's servant thought. So you see, Naaman, it said, was an enemy of Israel. But he knew something, he could get some help if he went and saw the prophet Elisha. He had a nasty skin disease that he had suffered with for a very long time. So Naaman went to see the king, and the king said, sure, go see Elisha. Now, but when Naaman got to Elisha's house, Elisha sent out his servant. and told the servant to tell him to go wash in the dirty Jordan River 7 times. And if he washed his body 7 times in the river, he'd be healed. Now, do you think Naaman believed this? He was thinking, let me think. Let me go into that river and my skin disease that I've had forever is just gonna disappear. Well, he listened to the servant and he went out and he washed in the Jordan River 7 times. And on that 7th time, he came up and his skin was cleared of the disease that he had had forever. Wow. So Naaman rushed back to tell Elijah, thank you. He could not believe what had happened, but he knew that Elijah was a prophet of God. So he knew that God had to be the one to help heal him. Wow. So when Elisha sees Naaman, Naaman tries to give him gifts for healing him. And Elisha said, nope, I serve the Lord. I do not need any gifts. But you see, Elisha's servant was looking at that chariot over there full of gold and silver and really pretty robes. And he was like, but I could use a new robe. But Elijah said, no, we do not need anything. So Naaman went, he left, and he knew that God was gonna help and he would follow God. So, but Elijah's servant followed after him and said, oh, wait. Elisha decided he wanted some gold or silver and a couple of those robes. We all know that was a lie, because Elisha said he did not need anything as payment for helping to heal Naaman. The only person who needed credit was God. So Elisha knew that his servant was going to do that and met him when he got back to the house and asked him where he got it from. And the servant didn't really want to give an answer. I mean, because at this point he knew he'd been caught, right? So what happens? Elisha tells that servant that him and his family and his descendants are going to be having the skin disease that Naaman had, and that he has lost all of his trust. Have you ever been in a situation where you've lost somebody's trust? It could be simply a friend. Maybe you told a friend that you promised them that you were going to do something. You made a promise and then you backed out. You think that friend's going to trust you the next time you make a promise to them? I know I wouldn't. Sometimes, keeping somebody's trust takes work. So by telling the truth and being an example and showing others that you stand by your promises and you stand by your word, even when no one's looking, that you're going to do the right thing. It's not always easy, right? It's not always easy to, sometimes it's easy to tell just a little white lie. But those little white lies turn into a big, big, bigger mess when they get found out. And when that happens, you usually lose somebody's trust. They don't believe your words anymore because you've told a lie and they don't know if they can trust you. I know that I want my friends and family to trust me, and I would hope that you would want your friends and family to trust you as well. So going into this week, I want you to think about, what choices can I make going in so that others could not lose trust in me? Because I want them to know that I am truthful. When I am truthful, I do not lose trust. I do not lose trust from my family. I do not lose trust from my friends. And I especially don't lose trust from God. And you know what? God is always truthful and faithful if you believe in him. Take Naaman, for example. He believed that Elisha, the prophet, could help clean his skin. And he did what God told Elisha to tell him to do, and he was healed. That is amazing to me. So just remember, integrity is choosing to be truthful in whatever you say or do. Even if being truthful may mean you're going to get in a little bit of trouble, it would be worth getting in trouble than losing somebody's trust. So I want us to bow our heads and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for allowing us to have this time together, Lord. I cannot wait for the day until all of your little children can come back to the church where we can teach and have worship together. God, help us to make wise choices. Help us to live a life full of integrity, to where when we talk to others and we talk to family and friends, they know that what we're saying is truthful and they can trust our word. It's in your name we pray, amen. Well, I hope that you enjoyed His Crew this morning. I hope you enjoyed the Bible story. I miss you guys. I cannot wait to see you. But until then, I'm going to give you an air hug and say, see you later.
Okay, today's devotion comes from How Great Is Our God? Miss Terry loves reading you these. Just a little added something at the end. This one is called Closer Than You Think. And the scripture it cites at the beginning is, the Lord himself will go before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you. He will not forget you. Don't be afraid. And don't worry. Deuteronomy 31:8. When you look up at the stars, space seems so far away. And while it's not like walking into your neighbor's house, it's closer than you think. In fact, in 2018, that's just 2 years ago, scientists started to think that it's even closer than they think. Scientifically speaking, space begins where the Earth's atmosphere ends, at a point called the Kármán line. For years, scientists believed that that line was 62 miles away. Now they think it might only be 50 miles away, which means that if you could drive a car straight up, you'd be in space in less than an hour. Space might seem impossibly far away, but it's really quite near. Like God. There will be times when he feels far away. Perhaps it's when you're hurting or you're sad, worried or afraid, or when you've done something you know is wrong. But God is always right there with you. That's a promise he gives over and over again throughout the Bible. When Joshua faced a terrible battle, God promised to be with him wherever he went. That's in Joshua 1:9 if you want to look it up. When Jesus was about to leave his disciples and return to heaven, he said, I will be with you always. That's from Matthew 28:20. God even says he will pick you up and carry you close to his heart in Isaiah 40:11. God's not far away. He's much closer than space. He's in your heart, right by your side, every moment of every day. What a great promise that is. The little prayer at the end says, God, because I can't see you with my eyes, it sometimes feels like you're very far away. Help me to see with my heart and mind and soul that you're always right here with me. Amen. Okay, boys and girls, it's time to do our memory verse. So everybody stand up, get on your feet, warm up your hands, get them ready. All right, our memory verse comes from Proverbs 10:9 in the NIrV version, or as we say in elementary, NIrV. Let's do it together. He goes, anyone who lives without blame walks safely, but anyone who takes a crooked path will get caught. That's Proverbs 10:9, NIrV. All right, let's do it one more time together. Here we go. Anyone who lives without blame walks safely. But anyone who takes a crooked path get caught. Proverbs 10:9, NIrV. Good job, boys and girls. Miss Terry is really proud of you. Keep learning that. It is getting really close now until we'll get to be together in person again. And I am excited about that. So keep praying, keep reading your Bibles, and we will see you real, real soon. Have a fantastic week. I love you.